start with NPM init, and we'll go ahead and git init. So, go ahead and do step one. Yeah, I will keep track of the steps that we're taking as we go. So step two would be to install I don't think I need to do this anymore. I think I have the latest version of NPM, which is so we'll do next, beta, react, DOM. You can use Yarn. I think most of the examples use Yarn. I'm just so programmed. So as that's downloading, what's our next step? So that should be all we need for now. We're eventually going to do now. Let's save that.
Again, you have a setup that where you can deploy another provider apart from now, right?
There are so many examples. It's kind of crazy. It's overwhelming at first because you're like, well, how do people use it? And there's just so many examples of how you can use it. But this is great if you're looking for something specific. If you want an Express server, a Happy Server code, you know, they have examples of all that stuff.
Yes. That's really neat. I saw Apollo in there too. They use GraphQL on that too.
Yeah, they have examples for pretty much everything that's popular in the React world.
What are those examples for? Those are setting up different. I saw some material UI. I use that.
Yeah. So it's how you would use that with Next, because it is configuration over convention, or I'm sorry, convention over configuration. But it's also like very configurable. That those things don't make sense right up front. It's pretty much like, we want you to just use it the way we built it because that's so easy, but we also want to allow you to do whatever. And so they need to explain it because it's usually like they created special ways of doing things. You know, it's not part of the next.
You couldn't use just the material UI.
Like the CSS and JS, you could just load that. You could load that. They have a head component, but they usually give examples of how you might do that. So let's just use that as an example.
How cloud friendly is Next.js? How cloud friendly is Next.js?
Yeah, it's definitely cloud friendly. Like I said, I think now has its own CDNs, but I mean I've used it in serverless technologies before, like GCP and Lambda, so it's definitely very cloud friendly. There's a great series of blog posts that I'll put in the README when I put this, and I'll post the source code up on Meetup. There's a great blog post that takes you through Next.js. I'm not going to remember everything, but pretty much you deploy an entire serverless Next.js app in like four blog posts.
So they're just implementing the highest level node to implement server side rendering, wrapping around. I'm familiar with the GUI theme provider.
Okay, I'm
With Material UI, you have to wrap all their components. That's the highest level. You get it to render, but so they wrap that component.
So this
that allows it to publish this React app to make it server side, right?
Yes.
That's pretty much. You typically have to do that, wrap some sort of component around your application first.
Exactly.
Okay.
So we would because it's page based. You got your pages here. Let's look, so this with root function right here. They're pretty much just,
yeah. Hierarchy component wraps
exactly
your page, and that allows it to render without JavaScript and sort of thing.
Yeah.
Okay.
Have you seen examples using AWS and Google Cloud APIs?
I know when I use those things, I usually use Lambda and Google Cloud Functions. So you're talking about going directly from here,
yeah,
hitting an API endpoint with,
yeah,
fetch? Yeah, yeah. There's definitely tons of fetch examples. And you can do all that like on an Express server. Anything you would do on a node server, you can do in this. So if you have a specific example, we can talk about it.
About hitting a DynamoDB on AWS.
Yeah.
From
here. I mean, in the past, I've definitely just done the API Gateway Lambda DynamoDB setup for the CRUD, and then you get your URL. So, do you mean something else, or?
Yeah, that should be it.
Yeah, that's traditionally how, if you just want to set up a simple DynamoDB API. And it's really easy if you've ever used serverless framework.
What's the high level on DynamoDB? I've never used that.
Do you know Cassandra? NoSQL?
Yeah. Yeah.
So they hard forked.
I've heard of that.
It's really different.
So it's just,
they've added a lot. And so you get that NoSQL, you know, really fast reads and writes and everything like that. And I know they just came up with auto scaling for DynamoDB, so you can go up and down with your DynamoDB tables and everything like that. So it's, yeah, it's pretty amazing. If you need NoSQL, I would always look at DynamoDB first and then maybe consider Cassandra, because it's just so much easier to do DynamoDB. But it doesn't do everything.
Yeah.
So, to the project. So I just did git ignore node modules and next. So the pages directory is where, that's the convention pretty much. That's the primary convention that they assume you're going to have. So you're going to have a pages directory. And then every file under that pages directory is a route. So if you do an index file, that's your index route. So let's just do a quick hello world. The home page here, it's pretty easy to find the scripts that are kind of the standard way to do the scripts for Next.js. You can just copy that in there.
Alright. I think it just fixed your mic volume.
Oh.
Cool.
Yeah.
Better.
Yeah,
there you go.
That was a little squeaky, wasn't it?
It was just about to scream at us, I think.
Yeah. All right, so usually there's port here. Might be having some kind of trouble. It's usually on port 3000. It's working. So, besides some questions, it probably took us like 2 minutes to set this up, including the NPM install. You know, it's pretty much all we did was NPM init, NPM y, so I see. Here we pretty much all we did was start the package, install Next, React, and React DOM. So you can bring whatever version of React you want. So if you are used to an old type, or you have an app that's using an old type and you want to be able to convert without having to, you know, use the new prop types library or something like that, you just don't want to mess with that right now, you can bring your own React version and it'll play nicely with that version. It's not fiber ready yet. As of like a week ago, it was almost there. Someone's working on it for sure. They want people to be able to play around with fiber and Next at the same time pretty soon. So keep an eye out for that if you want. Let's see. So then we created an index file and a pages directory, and that was all we did. And we have a server rendering app.
Can you just make one more route?
Yeah. So here's the script and stuff. So yeah, if we wanted to do an about page. And then about. So it's pretty convention over configuration, but that makes it easy to get started. So if we're creating something like a blog and we just want content up there, SEO ready, this is a great way to do it. So the next, so we'll go ahead and put it on now real quick. MDMISG.
Okay, what's the pricing model like for now if you do use them?
I have no idea. I've never paid for it. Let's check that. $15 a month for 50 new bandwidth, yeah. See if they talk about C. Yeah, personally, I wouldn't go with someone who doesn't offer CDN. So, but it's great, it's easy to use. There are actually a lot of benefits that I haven't looked at in a long time, so they probably even got better. Auto scaling.
Well, your CI is going to be also.
Is that for one domain or multiple? You know,
I think it's about five domains.
Oh, okay, there it is.
Time. Yeah.
Okay.
So when this limit is exceeded, you pay all the main price. But it has a base level of payment and then pay as you go, which is nice.
Does it need to be now, or can you use AWS? Or?
Yeah, you can use anything. It gives you assets that you can put anywhere. You have to know how to manage now inside of a node server, but it's pretty easy. All right, so we got that. I think we just did that. I was already logged in, so you would normally, I think you have to create an account. I'm not sure.
So it's like similar to like a Heroku.
Yeah.
Deployment.
Exactly, yeah.
So you basically have to create different like now apps, kind of like a Heroku. You have like different networks.
Yeah, but you don't have to do it in like an interface or anything. You can do it all from your command line, which is super nice. Do you have a desktop app?
But Heroku isn't really React
specific,
right? It's just kind of Rails started.
Well, it's a platform as a service.
Platform.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it's a similar deployment kind of thing,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah, definitely. If I were to go to the link, did they give us a link? Yeah, so if I go to this link right now, it actually shows this process. I missed it, but if I were to run now again, go here. Well, I guess because I already deployed it, it's just showing that kind of one.
Can you show the source of that? Does it have pages to be in everything, body, and, or is it just the header tag?
So, where is it? Shout it out.
Yeah, see, the about type page come out head link, yeah.
Here's the hello.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you don't care about the routes. You're just throwing JS files into pages, and that's your folder, right? You can create subfolders, and
yeah.
It'll just match it one to one with your file names, right?
Exactly.
Well, so does deep routing by default automatically, like folders, like if you get...
Recursive routing, right, he's saying.
I actually don't know. That's a good question. I've never done that.
So the React router gives you more flexibility on the routing, I'm guessing?
I know I've seen that you can have parameterized routes.
But the reason you had React router in that one app is so that it could do this client-side routing, right?
Yeah, I'm sorry I showed you guys that. That probably confused you.
Probably confused you.
That is not Next at all.
Right.
That was supposed to be an example of what you would do if you didn't use Next.
Oh, I see.
Yeah. I couldn't use Next because I had already built the entire React app. I even considered rebuilding it in Next. But yeah, so that was just how you use React and React DOM purely. Just the render the string function to do server-side rendering. Yeah.
Why do you like Next so much? What's your favorite part about it?
Well, I use Firebase a lot. So if you don't know what Firebase is, it's pretty much dropping a database into your front-end code.
Okay.
Kind of like you would an API, but instead of using Fetch, you just use the Firebase library. There's a lot of awesome helper stuff around Firebase, like with authentication and stuff like that. And then you also get real-time database right there. You can, instead of calling it once, you can just say on, and it turns on a function that watches changes in the Firebase and calls a callback, so you can pretty much just update your app immediately, and you don't have to write any backend code. So with Next.js, it gives you server-side rendering. And if you don't have any like database stuff and you use cloud functions like I do with Firebase most of the time, you don't have to write any server code. You just write functions that respond to Firebase calls, and you make all your Firebase calls within your React components, which I can show you.
That sounds like another cop.
Yeah,
entirely.
Yeah, it is. But I have seen a lot online of like pairing between Next.js and Firebase for that reason, because you just don't have to worry about so much stuff that usually you have to worry about when you use Next.js and Firebase. Both of them have that quality of, like, I don't need to worry about it, but when you put them together, there's just like exponentially more you don't have to worry about.
I guess I've never written an app without a server backend, so it's
yeah.
hard to visualize.
Yeah.
It's how do you do customizations on the data store? You know, how do you mutate that data store?
Yeah, so with Firebase, you just call it. I can do a quick example here, but we'll maybe do some like comments or something. And then you can have Google Cloud Functions works with Firebase so that when something's called, like say I want to create a charge in Stripe, when user ID / charges / charge key is called, when something new happens at that path, kind of like the React router at that path, you grab your keys from your environment, your Firebase environment, and then do all the Stripe stuff there.
Mm.
So.
You're like a microservices lover.
Oh man.
I can tell.
Serverless, actually.
Well, microservices,
but.
Basically, like what you enjoy.
The ultimate high is like not having to do anything and being able to build this amazing app.
Yeah.
Just focusing on user experience.
Cool.
Sure. So that, if you count up all the time we actually spent in the code, that was probably less than 5 minutes. So you can get up pretty quick with Next and now. Yeah, but the next step people normally do with Next is add a components folder and then have something like, call it main wrapper. So this would have like your header, your footer, and all that stuff. Head tag is something, it's isomorphic, so it sits inside your component, but Next is smart enough to say, oh, this head tag isn't actually rendered to the client, it's just for telling me what I should have in the head tag when I render to the client. So it's not technically, like, it doesn't render.